Well, good morning, family of God. How is everybody today? Well, it is a beautiful Sabbath day, indeed. And I want to say last evening we had a wonderful young adult meeting, and it was good to connect and see each other. And we did that in honor of something special going on this morning here at our church. And on that note, in a short while, we will see the privilege of have the privilege of Richard Clark being baptized, and this has been a journey, and I will probably talk about this when we're in the baptistry. But Richard is somebody who deliberately thinks through everything, and he'd never been baptized before, and he said, "Fine, this is the time." And so, on that note, we have a bit of official business. On the moment that he's baptized, is there a motion that we welcome him into the to membership? Is there a motion? Motion made, thank you. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise a hand. All right, can we say amen together? Amen, yes, amen. So I hope if you do not know Richard, you have undoubtedly heard his music as he's played violin for us numerous times, and I think he told the children's story recently, and you'll get to know him. I hope you do. Tonight at 5:00, we are having a church business meeting, and that will be on Zoom, and the link should have been sent to you, so you can join us on Zoom and also access. Probably the most important subject is the 2021 budget. And we're going to vote on that tonight. And around this time last year, we had a business meeting in the fellowship hall. And I remember it was truly a wonderful experience. We had just enough people. I think we had 50 people there, or maybe it was more, to have a, there was some criteria. Anyway, we had a lot of people in the fellowship hall. It was good. And we decided on a course of action for 2020. And praise God, it came to fruition. And now we're at the threshold of a question about what to do in 2021. So if for some reason you're not able to make the meeting, I'm going to humbly ask for your prayers that you will guide this body as we make the decision about navigating through a unique year, 2021, with COVID and everything going on, about when will this wrap up. So we're going to please keep us in prayer. But also be sure to join us at 5 p.m. on Zoom tonight. Next week, there's prayer meeting at 7 p.m. And we're having a wonderful discussion going through the book of Exodus. So we invite, there's always room for one more. And we're looking at the Friday evening services and how we want, what sort of curriculum we want to tackle with that. So please let us know if you have an idea, saying, hey, here's an idea about why don't we discuss this subject or go through this book of the Bible, or a book that we would read separately. So I believe that covers for our announcements. As far as offerings go, there's plates at the door, and of course we encourage people to continue to do so online. Something you'll notice by the door that you have probably never seen before at the college church, that we're gonna do today, thanks to a gift by one of our members, Wes Garvin. And we are going to shake hands. We're going to shake hands legally. And I say that because, you don't have to if you don't feel comfortable. But what we're going to do here is we have these little hand plastic mitts. All right, there's some at that door, some at the other door. And the reason why I'm doing this today is because Richard's getting baptized. And normally we would give good hearty handshakes. We might even give a hug. But because of COVID, we can't do that. So these are made available, and Richard and I will be staying at that door back there. And if you feel so led and comfortable, grab one of these here, disposable gloves. He'll have one on. Shake hands, praise God, and then just in the foyer, there's a garbage can you can use to throw them away. And I'm saying that because, you know, the Bible talks about us encouraging each other. And in some places, the Bible even does a really un-COVID thing, says, give each other a holy kiss. Obviously, we're not doing that. But my point is it's just good to welcome Richard into our church family. So that's going to be available there, and Fred may have handed a few of them out earlier. I believe that covers for our announcements. We want to pray that God will richly bless this service today and bless our friend and brother in Christ, Richard.
I would invite the congregation to stand for the invocation and the call to worship. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Dear Heavenly Father, we recognize that you do not need a special invitation to grace our service, that you are already present by your Spirit in the hearts of those gathered here to worship. We pray that nothing will distract us from the message you have for each one of us. May each part of the service help raise our hearts to heaven above as we prepare to spend all eternity with you. We pray in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Reese's peanut butter cup. I got to snack on some Fritos. Crunch on a carrot and an apple. And then the best part, the Häagen-Dazs ice cream bar. Wasn't it great? Well, let's see what's in the yellow cooler today. It's empty. Oh, I don't know whether to be sad or mad. Did somebody take my ice cream? Where is my ice cream? Jesus said to love one another. But how do you love people when they hurt you? How do you love people when they disappoint you? How do you love your brother when he breaks your toy? How do you love your sister when she calls you names? How do you love your friends when they won't play with you? I can't eat food, I can't eat ice cream from my cooler when it's empty. And I can't love people when my heart is empty of love. How can I fill my heart with love? For my cooler, I can go to the store and I can buy some food. I can buy some Haagen-Dazs ice cream bars and put them in my cooler and come to church and enjoy them. Can I go to the store and buy some love and put it in my heart? There are two steps to filling our heart with love. Step number one, somebody needs to love us. Step number two, we need to accept that love. Both steps are important, but neither step is easy. Oftentimes, we're not very nice, and it's difficult for people to love us when we're not nice. So it can be difficult for somebody to love us. That's step number one. And maybe even worse, a lot of times people do love us, but we can't accept their love because we don't feel like we deserve their love. We haven't earned the love, and so we can't accept it, or we just feel that we're too bad to accept the love. So those are the two steps that we need to fill our hearts with love, and neither step is easy. Do you know what a paradox is? A paradox is when two things are exactly opposite, but they're both true at the same time. And I'm going to tell you a paradox about love. It's an important paradox. Statement number one. Nobody deserves to be loved. Nobody. Nobody deserves to be loved. statement number two. Everybody deserves to be loved. Everybody deserves to be loved, no matter how bad. Everybody deserves to be loved. That seems crazy, but they're both true. Nobody deserves to be loved, and everybody deserves to be loved. In order to fill our hearts with love, we must accept that we don't deserve to be loved, and we must also accept that we do deserve to be loved. Is that crazy? That's a difficult trick. You just ask any of these old people, all of these old people sitting here, they're still trying to master that trick. It's the work of a lifetime, getting both of those in your heart at the same time. Jesus always loves us, even when we're not nice. He always loves us, even when we do not deserve to be loved. And we all don't deserve to be loved at some time or another. When you feel like nobody loves you, and we all feel that way sometimes, remember that Jesus loves you. And when you feel like you don't deserve to be loved, remember that Jesus made you to be loved. And this is why everybody deserves to be loved. Jesus made you to be loved. I wonder, can my cooler be a paradox? Can it be empty? Can it be empty with nothing in it and have food in it at the same time? Huh, look at that. I feel like I am loved. A Reese's peanut butter cup. That's good. We don't deserve to be loved, and we do deserve to be loved. That paradox, put it together, accept that Jesus loves you. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, your love for us is truly amazing. We don't deserve your love, and yet you made us to be loved. And the more we can accept that, the more you fill our hearts with love so that we can love others. Be with us today, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thermodynamics, though, the cold water at the bottom.
Well, today is indeed a very, very special day. Am I coming through? We'll see, yeah. And I'm going to invite any close family or friends who want to come forward and be more towards the front. It's good to see Richard's families here. And, oh, there we go, and friends. And this has been a long journey for Richard. And as I mentioned earlier, you are somebody who thinks things through and studies, want to know the details. And you've never been baptized before. And I remember you said, you know, you came to me one day and said, you know, I think it's time for me to take the step. And I'm going to tell you from the bottom of my heart, I'm honored to be part of your journey on this and be your pastor. And I know your family is just so thankful that they would be here and be a part of your life. You know, it's baptism is, as I've told you before, and I say it 100 times, baptism is really a starting point. It is a starting point. And it's where we begin sort of a milestone of our walk with the Lord. And as we go from that point, you will find, and I mentioned this to you before, but that we will go through peaks and valleys, ups and downs. And what's important to realize is that we all do that. It's very normal. We all do that. And what's important to realize is that when you look out here, you see your family and you see also your spiritual family. And I want you to consider all of us your brothers and sisters in Christ. And please, Richard, always feel free to call us and we will call on you, because what's happening today is you're becoming part of the body of Christ. And amen is right. And that means that you have a role to play. And you've already played for us many times the violin, you've told the children's story, and who knows, Richard, what lies in the future? Who knows what lies in the future? And I do know one thing, that if we keep our eyes fixed on Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith, wonderful things will happen. Wonderful things will happen. So what I'd like to do is, with all the people who are baptized, is have a special prayer for them. So why don't we bow our heads in prayer this morning? Father in heaven, Lord, we want to thank you this morning. We want to not just thank you, we want to celebrate this morning for Richard. We want to thank you, Lord, for blessing our lives with his life. We want to pray that our lives will be a blessing to him as well. We want to pray, Lord, that as he continues on his journey with you, with this being a major milestone, a starting point, we pray that you will be with him at all times. We pray that you'll be with him in the moments of victory and the moments of setback. Lord, we want to pray that he will realize, too, that we are with him in the moments of celebration and the moments of loss. We pray, Lord, that we will, as his spiritual brothers and sisters, that we will be a blessing to him. And Lord, as he continues to use his gifts and his skills to your honor and your glory, we pray he'll continue to be a blessing to us. And Lord, we pray that all this will be done to your honor and to your glory. As Richard is baptized this morning, may you continue to baptize him and bless him with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Testing. Okay. All right. Remember grabbing there and there. Okay. Richard, because Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins, because you've accepted him as your Lord and as your Savior, it is our privilege today to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'm going to give you a... Amen. And all God's people said? Amen. Amen. Amen.
As we prepare for our corporate prayer, if you would like to kneel or stay in your seats, that is fine, but let's all bow together before our God. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We humbly bow before you with great thankfulness for your countless mercies and for bringing us to yet another Sabbath. We also thank you for the baptism that we have just seen, and we ask a special blessing upon Richard. For some, the past week has brought joy, for some, sadness, for others, difficulties. And we sometimes tire of this old world, but we do look forward to the earth made new and how glorious that will be. We yearn for that time. We yearn for the new earth, but we are admonished to give thankfulness and rejoice for the good as well as the bad times, and that can be a very hard lesson. We come before your throne this morning with our ever-growing list of those who need your healing hand upon them. And we know that our needs are well known to you and that you will answer. And this morning, I would like to bring two names that are not formally on our list of two ladies who were parishioners here and are now elsewhere. Their names are Janelle Bingham and Jean Camara. And we pray for their ongoing healing from surgery and illness. And we ask that they and all those on our prayer list today will be aware that you are very close to them. On another front, we ask, dear Father, that you will see to eradicating the virus in your time. It's dominated our lives for the past year. We are tired. But we do thank you that nonetheless, we can all either meet here in person or have the ability to meet virtually, despite the horrible problems that the virus has caused. We ask your blessing today on the spoken word and the music, and we pray that in all things your name will be glorified. And my prayer this morning continues with what John told us long, long ago. And he stated, "Beloved, I wish above all things that you may prosper and be in good health, even as your soul prospers." God bless all of you, and God bless America. In the beautiful name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Our scripture reading today is found in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 through 8. I'm going to be reading through the New Revised Standard Version, and if you're following along in the Pew Bibles, it's on page 987. Again, 2 Peter 1, 5 through 8. For this very reason, you must make every effort to support your faith with goodness, and goodness with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with endurance, and endurance with godliness, and godliness with mutual affection, and mutual affection with love. For if these things are yours and are increasing among you, they keep you from being ineffective and unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.
So, I notice sometimes that pastors' memories can be flawed. But I'm going to say, my friends, this has been a special, special Sabbath day for me. And I told Richard it's my first baptism here at the college church, and truly was a privilege to baptize him. And we are blessed to, as I said, call him our brother in Christ. So let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, it is good to be here today, and we are on holy ground. And Lord, as we have welcomed Richard into our lives, we realize that he is also welcoming us into his. And so, Lord, we pray that as we are on this journey together, that we will, as the Bible tells us, to spur one another on towards good deeds. Lord, may we learn as we sit at the feet of a man named Peter and learn from his experience. And Lord, we pray that as we leave here later today, we will know that we have been in your presence. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. The story is told about a group of tourists who were visiting a picturesque village. And it was just a beautiful village, a tiny village. And there was an old man standing beside a fence, and one of the tourists, in a sort of condescending way, said, "Were any great men born in this village? It's so small. Who could ever come from here?" And the man, the old man by the fence, simply said, "Nope, only babies." And that's a simple fact. Biologically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, we all start out as babies. We all start out as babies. But we didn't remain there. We've grown in all those areas. And we've grown with bumps, scrapes, and bruises. And one of those people who had a big, big bump was a guy named Peter. Now, Peter wrote a letter, and 32 years before he writes a letter, he has a big bump that's there in the Bible for all of us to read and to study and to analyze. It's there. Actually, there's not just one, there's two, there's even three and more. And fortunately, Jesus gives him yet another chance. He gives me another chance. He gives us another chance. And he has open enrollment. Open enrollment, and the test question is really simple. Do you love me? Do you love me, and do you love me? Now, this guy named Peter writes a letter to the believers in what we would call modern-day Turkey. It's around the year 65 AD. Nero's on the throne, and we believe probably that Peter will be martyred shortly after he writes this letter. Now, I'm saying that because I want us to turn our Bibles to 2 Peter chapter 1. And Peter begins the letter by saying, "Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who through the righteousness of God, of our God and Savior Jesus Christ, have received a faith as precious as ours. Grace and peace be yours, the NIV says, in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. The RSV actually says, may grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of Jesus Christ our Lord. It's important to realize who's writing this. It's a guy who 3 decades ago really, really blew it. And there was that pivotal moment we all have studied and analyzed when it was under the pressure, and he finally says, you know what? I don't even know you. And then he becomes welcome back. And it totally transforms his life. Because he says in verse 3, his divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory, by his own glory and goodness. Now, it's interesting, his divine power, the Greek word there is actually thesis, we get the word theology, and dynamos, we get the word power and dynamite. So let me just throw out there a very loose translation. He has given us divine dynamite. He's given us divine dynamite so that we can have everything we need for a godly life. Now, the Greek word there isn't bios, it's zoe, life, for the purpose. And so the idea here is we have what we need to live a godly life, and the key is to knowing God. Now, I always say that to know God, the word relationship is spelled T-I-M-E. That's how you spell a relationship, T-I-M-E. And Peter understands this, and he talks about the knowledge of him who called us. Now, you and I are all on a journey. In perhaps a year or less, this man writing this letter will love his Lord and Savior so much that he, as history tells us, will choose to be crucified upside down because of what Jesus meant to him. Now, with that little background, let's jump into verse 4. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promise, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. Now, on this day in history, some 3 things happened that I wanted to highlight this morning to help drive home this important sentence here. He wants us to participate in the divine nature. Now, on this day in history, 3 things I'm going to share with you. Number one, in 1968, Dwight Eisenhower made a hole in one. All right? Dwight Eisenhower, yes, that guy, hits a hole in one. Now, that's what I call trivial trivia. Totally useless information. Second fact, on this day in 1952, Queen Elizabeth, the same queen that we know today, who I believe is 95 years of age, was put on the throne. This day, 1952. But thirdly, on this day in 1935, a board game was put on sale called Monopoly. Now, I'm saying that, which of these 3 events has impacted your specific life the most? Well, Eisenhower's hole-in-one, that's just trivial. That's nonsense. Totally, you know. Queen Elizabeth, maybe you follow the royals. Maybe you've met the queen. Maybe you've had tea with her. That might be interesting. But for most of us, she's a person on the television. You see, once in a blue moon, there she is waving her hand. Thirdly, however, Monopoly. How many here have a board game at home called Monopoly, or a variant thereof? All right, good. About half of us, more than half. I'm saying that because they have variations. It's even a Bible-opoly. Yeah, you build churches instead of homes, all right? That's the idea there. But same idea. And I'm saying this because the thing about a game of Monopoly is you participate in it. We don't participate in anything. We have nothing to do with Eisenhower. We really have nothing to do with the queen, but at the end of the day, it's that board game called Monopoly in our closets and wherever it might be in a cabinet that really impacts our lives, and we participate in it. Now, I'm saying this because, to some degree, this is emblematic of where we are in our spiritual lives. Some of us, have more of an Eisenhower golf trivia relationship with God. We know some things about the Bible. There's 66 books in the Bible. Paul wrote much of the New Testament. Moses wrote the first books of the Old Testament. We know these facts. Then you have the queen. Oh, yeah, there's the queen. And she shows up on TV, and we say, oh, yeah, and maybe if we ever saw her, we'd wave. And sometimes we can have this relationship with God. Oh, I'll see you at church. I'll see you next week, God. And then we have that Monopoly game. Participating. Where you pull it out, and you actually engage, and you know that moment when you realize you're bankrupt, or you might actually win the game. But you're playing it, and you've got your opponent or your family member, your friend across the board, and you're engaged in this. Now, I'm saying all this because Peter wants us to participate in the divine nature. This is not just some sort of academic idea, academic experience. This is something we're actually doing. Now, this shows up in many different ways, in strangest of ways. It may show up, God may show up in the town called Bethlehem. He may show up on the road to Damascus. He may show up in a place called Lancaster, Massachusetts. He shows up. And one of the ways he shows up is in John 13, where it says there, he now showed them the full extent of his love. And you know what he did? He washed the feet of the people who should be washing his feet. That was a moment. Right there, to participate in the divine nature. It's in those moments, those almost nondescript, easily avoidable and ignorable moments that we participate in the nature of God. I came across some writings by a lady named Judy Canato. Article called Paradox Road. Paradox Road. And in there, she talks about the rules of the road. I want to share these with you. What appears to be a detour may be the most important leg of the journey. That one takes a while to swallow. What may appear to be a detour may be the most important leg of the journey. Second thing, too much concern for safety is dangerous. Thirdly, time travel is required. We must leave the past, we must leave the future. We must be present. Fourthly, sometimes we travel farthest by sitting still. Next, enemies and strangers can make the best travel companions. And lastly, it is permissible to ask for directions. I'm saying this because Peter is taking us someplace very, very deep and personal to him. And he begins by the fact that we all know who he is. We all know his history. We all know that he does tend to buckle under pressure. We all know that he's concerned about things that are going around him. And sometimes he can take his eyes off Jesus. We know these things. But we also know underneath it all, he wants to be a different person. He wants to change. He wants to see something happen in his life that couldn't ordinarily happen. Speaking about a man named Peter, there's another Peter I want to tell you about. His name is Peter Gomes. And he wrote these words. He said, "Let me start with a word of confession, usually a good place to begin. I want to be better than I am. And I know for the most part who I am and what I am. That is why I take the Christian faith seriously. It gives me a chance. That is why I like church. It gives me a chance. That is why I like the scripture. It gives me a chance. I want to be a better than I am. And part of the reason is that I know who I am." Peter, talking about 1 Peter, understands that all too well. He wants to be a better person. He wants to not buckle. So there, with that background, he takes us into an interesting list of 7 virtues. I would almost say he's taking us into boot camp. Because he says, for this very reason in verse 5, make every effort to add to your faith goodness. And to goodness, knowledge. And to knowledge, self-control. And to self-control, perseverance. And to perseverance, godliness. And to godliness, mutual affection. And to mutual affection, love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. I don't think what we just read is just the biblical text. I don't think it's just biblical truth. I'm going to venture to say that Peter opens up his heart and he says, listen, church, here is my experience. You don't have to make the same mistakes I did. You don't have to go down those same roads. And with true humility, he picks up that pen and he writes these lists down. And you say, well, why this list? Peter's got the virtues. Paul mentions the fruits of the Spirit. Why is he telling us this? Because he knows. He knows what we need to participate in the nature of God. And he knows what he needed to develop in his own life. He begins with goodness. Goodness. Oh, I'm sure he remembers 3 decades prior to this, that moment that he was in a squabble with the disciples over who was going to be the greatest. And he says, you know what? Man, that was a waste of time. I was walking with God, and I was concerned about me. Then he says, add to goodness knowledge. And then, oh, no. Couldn't I figure it out? Couldn't I connect the dots? I mean, Jesus, he was a descendant of David, and all these other pieces came into place. He was born in Bethlehem. All these were prophesied. Why didn't I know just a little bit more? Why didn't I go over the scrolls a little bit more? Why didn't I know a little bit more? Because I would have known that this is the guy. And it would have saved me so much heartache. And then, of course, why didn't I know myself better? About where my weak points are, what my breaking points are. And then he says, he adds to knowledge, self-control. Oh, I'm sure he can talk long about this one. Because you remember Peter, the guy who walked on the water? What happened? He's out there, and he's got his eyes fixed on Jesus, and for a short while he's walking on water, but then he loses that control. He loses the control. And he begins looking at the waves, at the storm, and suddenly things fall apart and he needs Jesus to rescue him. Or shortly thereafter, it's in Gethsemane. And Peter has had it. Emotions are high. There's so much going on. He's not sure what's going to happen, but he really knows what he wants Jesus to do. Get rid of the Romans. And here comes the Romans. Here comes the guard. And there's this one guy, his name is Malchus. He says, no, you're not going to do what I think you're going to do. So in a moment when he says, I've had it, he grabs a sword and he's going to go for the jugular, but a miracle happens and he only cuts off the ear. Jesus rescues him again. Yeah, I thought about this and Peter should have been shackled up right then. But Peter picks up the ear and puts it right back on the head of Malchus, and all goes on as if nothing had ever happened. Self-control. Peter says, man, you're going to need that. Perseverance. Peter would say, Jesus persevered with me for 3 years. Jesus persevered with me for 3 years. Couldn't I have persevered with him? Couldn't I have persevered with him on that critical night? Couldn't I have done that? He put up with my nonsense. Why couldn't I have been with him during that moment? I could have stood by the cross. I could have been there, encourage him. Instead, I did what everybody else did. And speaking about that night, he talks about godliness. He realized what went on in his mind and his heart. And he was just out to protect his own skin, very human thing to do. And so when they begin associating Peter with Jesus, he says, no. And he swears he doesn't know him, and he calls down curses, and it's as if he's trying to do anything he can to not look godly. And then that leads us to the next quality, mutual affection. It's in that moment when Jesus hears what's going on, and he turns and he looks at Peter, and Peter looks his way, and their eyes meet. Their eyes meet. And Peter says, we need mutual affection, because in that moment, he saw in the eyes of his rabbi, his Lord, only love, compassion, and even sorrow for him. But not a tinge of anger or resentment. Mutual affection. And then he talks about that last ingredient that we need, and Peter knows it well, love. Because after it's all said and done, for the readmission program, we shall say, the question is simply, do you love me? So Peter says, listen, if you're going to make this thing work, I got to work on that, love. And then he says something interesting, because there's no quantity to this, because it says in verse 8, he says, for if you possess these qualities, not in a measurable amount, but in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's not just one cup of knowledge and one cup of goodness and a tablespoon of perseverance. It's keep on doing these things. That's the way we have a productive Christian life, Peter would tell us. Because as he looked back over 3 decades of his own life, he sees what he needed to do in those critical moments. And he says, listen, here's some advice. Here's some tidbits. Here's some pointers. If you really want to thrive, implement these, and it will make all the difference. I want to close with a story that I came across from HMS Richards. It's a story that comes to us from the rather, shall we say, crude years of England. You see, there were two brothers. These two brothers were accused, and they were found guilty of stealing sheep. Sheep stealing. So they were caught, they were apprehended, and the penalty was really strange and cruel and bizarre. What they would do is they would take these two individuals, the convicted thieves, and on their foreheads they would brand the letters S-T, as in sheep thief. So that for all eternity, for all their lives, earthly lives, everyone would be reminded about what they did. Well, one of the brothers, he just couldn't handle this. He ended up leaving the village, wandered from around the land, and eventually died in an obscure way, running away from home. The other brother, however, said, I can't get away from the fact of what I did. I once stole sheep. And I am going to remain here until I win back the respect of my neighbors and my own self-respect by the grace of God. Well, over the years, he did just that. Over the years, he developed himself to being one of the local trustworthy and sages, one of the wise people of the village. And when you could, he was an honest man, he was a decent man, and people come to respect him. Well, the years went on, and this man became an old man. And he was wobbling down the street one day, and there happened to be a visitor in that town that day. And he saw this man wobbling down the town street with the initials ST still branded on his forehead. And this visitor asked a local person, says, I see that man over there. You see him? He says, yes. He says, what's with him? I mean, what's with those letters, ST, on his forehead? What does that mean? And the local man said, you know, it happened so long ago, I can barely remember it. I have forgotten the particulars, but I think the letters are an abbreviation for the word saint. Saint. Peter had that experience. Peter had that experience. May we learn from his experience and take his boot camp, shall we say, to heart.
Thank you.
After the benediction, myself and Rich will be at the back door there to greet one another, but let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, it has been good to be in the house of the Lord today. We want to thank you for this truly blessed day. Thank you for the gift of our relationship with you and with each other and with our brother Richard. We pray the Lord that as we are on this journey together, may we heed the words of Peter to add to our lives these qualities so that we can stand on Peter's shoulders as we seek to reflect your love, your truth, to a world that so desperately needs it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.